please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
The Nikkei is up more than 200 points just to kickstart trade. Remember, this is following a big rally that we saw in the US markets. This merger is not going through for now. They're saying, but they're looking at, you know, optimizing costs. They're looking at various synergy benefits.
This, I think, is a rally in which once again, the market is giving you an opportunity, I think, to correct your portfolio, to move out of junk and move into good quality stocks. 10,608 thereabout is the first equilibrium on the Nifty. And on the bank Nifty, somewhere around 25,600.
Punjab National Bank has said that the fraud that they had already disclosed on the 14th Feb could go up by an additional $204 million, which is roughly 1,320 crore rupees.
India has need for more bigger financial institutions that can underpin its continuing economic growth. So it's a story we like, and in some ways this merger is our reinvestment in that story.
The market's at about 10,563, which means we're about 20 points off the lows.
Okay, the market right now trading at almost the low point of the day. On the bank Nifty and on the mid cap, it clearly is. On the Nifty, IT stocks are trying to support the market. And on that, we are still off the low point. This is Closing Bell. I'm Anuj, with me is Surabhi. Hi, Surabhi. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Anuj. Yeah, I guess IT, and had it not been for Reliance, perhaps, you know, the screen would have looked even worse off today. But what is the sense? I mean, today, obviously, PSU banks were the biggest negative cue from the morning. Does it look like it'll kind of stabilize here?
You know, Surabhi, if you remember, you know, go back 24 hours, this is what I was talking about yesterday as well. And, you know, we've made this point in the morning as well, that what you had was a powerful, you know, perhaps a counter trend sort of bounce. That's now, you know, and now you're running into resistance. This morning, it all boils down to risk reward. This morning, the risk reward was not in your favor after two back-to-back days of centuries and the kind of you know, resistance that you were sitting at. Classical, you know, last time also the market slipped from 10,638. Look at today's high, and that's also the 20-day moving average. So it's showing you signs of that. Once again, the bank Nifty is struggling. You know, you could argue that the problem is with PSU banks. And why is the bank Nifty itself down about 300 points? The bank Nifty is essentially large cap private banks. Yeah. They're only, you know, PSU banks don't count for much in the bank Nifty. And IT is once again, you know, beginning to make a move. Rupee is making a move. So that trend that we had towards the end of February, which was IT stocks was out, you know, were outperforming, banks were down, currency was sort of underperforming. That sort of trend could be back. Of course, it will also need follow through. It will also need confirmation. And for all you know, in the last hour, there might be some, you know, covering which might again take the market higher. That could happen. But the short point is that it's not going to be one way recovery back for the market. It's not going to be a V chart. You know, it never is. It, you know, requires some consolidation. You know, these moves make you look like, you know, as if the best is again starting. But it takes time and it takes some effort. Yeah. Let's see. For now, last hour, I think it's anyone's call. But my sense is, looking at the bank Nifty's intraday chart in particular, it's looking a bit weak. And the mid-caps in particular, you know, the advanced decline is telling you that once again, there's some problem with the mid-cap.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, today, PNB was joker in the pack. And let's not forget that overnight, we'll be getting that testimony from the incoming Fed chair. So again, those bond yields continue to be the biggest talking point internationally. So who knows?
You position yourself in this last hour of trade. Ashwini Gujral and Mitesh Thakkar now join us with Closing Strategies. Good afternoon. Ashwini, your thoughts on the day and for last hour, is there a call here? And in terms of individual stocks, how would you approach it?
See, we should have expected a better day in case the bank Nifty would not have sort of misbehaved. But, you know, there's a bigger issue here that the kind of falls these PSU banks are seeing, they are basically writing off the entire corporate, you know, banks. So if, you know, your entire corporate bank space is kind of in trouble and you can't trust, you know, the books that are there, and every evening there is a new bad loan, etc., you know, that will bring the weightage of bank Nifty in the Nifty lower. So that way, you know, bank Nifty is probably becoming more vulnerable. Nifty probably is still flat because IT is positive. But as I think, you know, in the banks, there could be further trouble and it may start to underperform even if the Nifty goes up. So I would think that there is more trouble in banks, and most of these PSU banks could still go down further, even from current levels. So it's that kind of, total shedding of all sorts of financials. That was expected given the weightage it had assumed. Having said that, individual stocks, Dewan Housing is a sell with a stop of 570, target of 555. Bank of India is a sell with a stop of 124, target of 112. And Jubilant is a buy with a stop of 2000, target of 2150.
Okay, such is the ferocity of the PSU bank sell down, Anuj, that even a stock like IDBI Bank, I mean, that Lone Ranger, even that one has not been spared in today's action. Even that's down about 6-7%. Okay, let's also bring in Mitesh and his thoughts on today's action. What have you made of today's weakness, Mitesh, and what are the last hour calls?
Good afternoon. So I'm not overly worried about the weakness. I think we did expect 10,620, 630 to at least provide 2-3 days of consolidation and some supply and profit booking from people who would have bought at lower levels in the last 2 days. Plus also this is a level where sellers will try and make an attempt to push the market down. Having said that, I think I would be okay as long as we are not breaking below 10,500, 490. I think that's where the gap for yesterday remains, and this also an area where the intraday averages are converging. On the Bank Nifty, the corresponding level, if I was to highlight, would be right at 25,340 to about 25,318, and the Bank Nifty is right there. So it's at the support. Coming to my ideas, I have one sell that's in the PSU banking list. I have a sell on Canara Bank. I think this is one stock which has broken its very important support of 305, 303. So keeping a stop at 305, sell for targets of 282, and Equitas is the buy call, which I would recommend buying with a stop at 146 for targets of 157.
Fair enough. As we speak, PNB is down 12%. Bank of India is down about 7.5%. Union Bank down 5.5%, Canara down about 4.7%. SP Tulsian of SPTulsian.com and Kunj Bansal, ED and CIO of Centrum, now join us. Good afternoon, gentlemen. Mr. Tulsian, first, how to approach this whole PSU bank mess now? Because, this is a fresh news that came from PNB that the amount could be larger and not just that, 11,600 crores. And in sympathy, we've seen other PSUs also fall. So do you need to take a sector call here that just stay away, or do you need to take a bottom-up stock call here and buy some of these PSU banks as well?
See, if you keep getting this kind of news that yes, there are more skeletons in the closet, so I don't think that the relief is going to be coming in. And in fact, in case of the other PSU banks like maybe Bank of Baroda and all that, people have started fearing that maybe the African operations, African branch and all sort of things. So and still, unless until, there are two things. Firstly, that we must know that all the liabilities or all the frauds have of PNB got crystallized, number one, or have come on the surface, number one. Number two, there must be some kind of direction by the central bank that yes, that money has to be paid back by the PNB to all the banks, maybe like Allahabad Bank or those who have honored the fraudulent non-fund-based instruments of PNB. Once that happens, then you can say that the things have bottomed out. Until then, I think these kind of fears will continue to remain, because then this will not get spread to other banks. If other banks are got saved by the liability, being honored by the PNB, and if it revolves around only one bank, that is PNB, then that could be taken as a respite. But unless until, if we keep getting these kind of things, that $200 million additional are coming in, market is not, it is not the quantum, it is ultimately the fear of these kind of recurring frauds, which are seen keep coming in on surface, that is in fact scaring the market so much on the PSU banks.
Okay. Ashwini, just wanted a follow-up question on the index trade, if there is one. Looking at the fall on the Nifty bank now, would you look at any positions for the last hour? Would you look at perhaps, going contra and maybe buying this dip?
See, Nifty bank, the problem is that, private banks could keep moving up, whereas PSU banks could keep moving down. But with, sort of today's high, people can go short and see what happens, because just one bank, which is Yes Bank, is higher. Rest all are lower. So somewhere the sense is that if PSU banks go down, they will take private banks with them. I don't think you will have a situation where privates keep going up and PSUs fall. So somewhere, I think the short trade on Bank Nifty can be taken, of course, with the high of the day type of stop.
Okay, well, we also have Kunj Bansal with us. Kunj, your thoughts on the moves that we've seen on IT, you know, a little bit of that rally continues even today, selectively speaking. Would you look at buying anything afresh?
The one word answer is no. Let me just explain it. So we are seeing a little bit of correction in today's market after a few trading sessions wherein we have seen the market. And IT being a defensive sector is typically moving in the way a defensive sector should. So it had taken a back seat in last few days when market was continuing to go up and high beta sectors were participating, mainly the banking sector. Today in a correcting market, in a falling market, obviously the high beta stocks are taking a knock, and which is where the defensive sectors, more specifically the IT sector, has come, has seen the money moving into it, and that's the reason for its short rise. That doesn't make it a case for certainly a medium and a long-term investing, because the growth rate of the industry in general is likely to be lower, which is being consistently seen over the last few quarters. Even for the trading, it's very difficult to take a call in the IT sector that whether one will be able to get a 3-4% kind of rise from here or not. That doesn't look like.
Okay, all right. Mr. Tulsian, you know, the other stock we just wanted to talk to you about was GAIL. Today there's been some buying in gas stocks in general, in specific GAIL. What would the recommendation be from here on?
See, in fact, maybe if you take a call on this PNGRB, you know, probably the process of the clearances have all started, because earlier there was no quorum. Now all, and in fact that is keeping us positive on practically on all the gas-based stocks, not only on GAIL, but maybe MGL, IGL, GSPL, Petronet, LNG, because if you see the kind of gas price reduction having seen in the month of January, in fact they hardened in the month of December, and that is seen quite positive for these gas stocks as well. And apart from the city gas distribution, if I take a call on Mahanagar Gas Limited, they have all been expanding in the eastern suburbs of the Mumbai, maybe like Ambernath, Lombivali and all that, where the offtake is going to get increased. So practically in every gas stock there is a trigger to play on, which are seen quite positive and which are seen a sustainable trigger, which can, you know, see the earning growth getting erected into the financial working of all these companies maybe over next 2 to 4 quarters. So we are keeping positive view on all the gas stocks, including GAIL.
Okay, gas stocks have done well. Ashwani, on Infosys, what would be the next levels to watch? As we speak, it's at the high point.
IT yesterday was down, today has moved up. But again, you know, the IT index is up hardly 16 points. Mm-hmm. So it's not like Infosys is blowing the lights out. But maybe, you know, we could be in this 1100, 1200, 1220 type of range. So on the upside, I think 1200 should be a resistance.
Everything that's down today, let's not lose sight of where the buyers are still queuing up. Avenue Supermarts is definitely one such story. 3.5% up on that stock. And overall, NBFCs are finding the going tough. No such problem for Groove Finance. Avenue, you can see some, you know, fresh buying now emerging. Stock at the day's high. And then there's Groove Finance. Another good day for this one. About a 4% up move coming through as well. Mr. Tulsian, now what do you think of Avenue at current prices?
See, definitely the stock is looking expensive, but you have to go by the growth, or, you know, pick up the comparable peers like Future Retail, which has not participated in this kind of things. Because if you see the market cap or maybe the differential between the working of both the companies, you find DMart or the Avenue Supermart, you know, way ahead in the terms of the valuations. But I think this is the low float loyalty of the float, which is held by the retail investors, is seen making the stocks to move up so much. So maybe if you purely take a fundamental, then probably the stock will look expensive. But we have been advising that probably look for the momentum plus the growth which the company is capable to project in the next couple of years. But taking cue on the valuation of this Avenue Supermart, one can look to enter into the Future Retail also at the current price, which looks quite compelling at the current valuation.
Okay, Mr. Chen, before we thank you, just wanted your thoughts on this whole ACC Ambuja saga, and, you know, how should shareholders read this news now?
See, actually, if you really take a call, probably I don't think that much is going to get, you know, affect this, because both the stocks are seen having got removed from the Nifty 50. And if you really see, probably I'm not disappointed. In fact, I see that it is better that uncertainty has got over. And if now you really want to play, probably ACC looks quite good, because the efficiency or the efficiency parameter or the operating leverage, both, you know, all these things are going to be seen more in case of ACC, because Ambuja is already seen quite efficient in terms of all parameters. So there the terms of maybe the growth or in terms of the increase in the production increase or maybe the margin increase is seen to be lower in case of Ambuja Cement. So now, because this merger is not seen going through, probably it is better to focus on ACC, because the kind of numbers which you have seen from ACC for last two or three quarters are really seen to be quite attractive. And if that same momentum or same pace of quantity growth and margin expansion is going to be seen, I think ACC looks a very decent buy at the current time.
Okay. Let's just take the conversation forward on banks, and that continues to be, of course, the big news-making sector of the day. We have Ajay Srivastava joining us on the phone line in just a bit. We also have Mr. Ashwin Parikh with us to talk about really the way forward for PSU banks. Mr. Parikh, good afternoon. Thanks for joining in. You know, the market's discomfort is very apparent today, because, you know, till now you thought, okay, 11,400 crores and this is kind of priced in. But do you see these numbers getting larger? I mean, is there a risk of contagion spreading to other banks as well?
Well, I mean, I can see that there may be, you know, possibly some more of it. And the reason, I mean, let me just explain, you know, the reason for this is that for some trades where value addition happens in India, I mean, particularly, for example, in case of raw diamonds, and which are then brought to India, polished, and then they are exported. Normally, we find, you know, that instruments that the banking system normally uses include LOUs or revolving OLCs. So these are common instruments. They have been used over several years. Now, it was assumed in the past that, let's say, each time, a new LOU becomes functional, that is, it becomes operational and the exposure is at the bank's end, you would assume that the previous LOU would have been settled. Unfortunately, in this particular case, we realized that each LOU was actually growing in size, but with no trail of having settled the previous ones. And then the Indian banks at the international branches accepted this, because they thought that the LOU signing bank, that is Punjab National Bank, was settling these transactions. Now, in the backdrop of this explanation, I do believe that some more LOUs may perhaps come out of the system. Mm. I mean, not just with PNB, but perhaps for this particular trade finance, for this particular part, we may find that some of the more banks may come out with such LOUs.
Okay. Ashwin, good afternoon. So in that case, what's the next step forward? Should we have a forensic audit of all the PSU banks? Because, you don't know what next would come out. And right now, PNB has come out and said that, look, the amounts could be larger because there are a couple of more transactions. So what should be the step forward? Public at large would want to know, right, what this whole mess is in the PSU banks.
Sure. I mean, let me first react to this. I don't believe that forensic audit is really called for. The reason is very simple. You see, a normal method of trade finance, if someone is using without the intent of fraud, I mean, in case of PNB, I'm not talking about, let's say, several other such transactions in the system, but in this particular one, if the concerned people, you know, were, I mean, they were very aware of what they were doing and they did it with the intent of fraud, then it becomes a different story altogether. So, I mean, if you're going to chase, you know, phantoms, let's say, everywhere, then you may end up perhaps incurring more expenses and more of hunt cost, you know, rather than actually addressing the issue. The issue is each and every bank is well equipped, to my mind, to examine all their pending LOUs and see, you know, once again, see whether, I mean, there is a recoverability in those instruments.
Okay. That point is taken. Now, there's a stock angle as well. As we speak, PNB stock is down about, 12%. But others are also down. Bank of India is down about 8%. Union is down 5.5%. Ajay Srivastava is also with us. Ajay, good afternoon. So, you know, this is really interesting. PNB, as we speak, is in double digits. It was just a while back. I mean, just 3 or 4 months back when we had that PSU bank recap, it had gone to 220. And what a spectacular fall it's been for PNB. But most of the other PSU banks, barring an SBI, are making a move back towards their lows. Your sense of, you know, what's going on here, and as a shareholder, what should be the decision now?
Well, I think, see, there are no investee shareholders in PSU Bank to start with. I think whoever has bought PSU banks are all arbitragers who are there for speculative money. There's no investment thesis for these banks, so let's not even call people who got money in PSU banks as investors. It's speculation money which can go plus or minus. Number two is, there is a method to this madness. You know, if you look at the whole PNB and PSU bank situation, what have they done? They have converted a set of circumstances into saying nobody is responsible. The customer, Mr. Nirav Modi, is accountable. That goes for Mr. Simboli Sugar. That goes for X and Y. The nationalized banks, officials, RBI, everybody has put his hands up and said it's a fraud. And only one person called the customer who's done the fraud. When such kind of behavioral pattern exists in an organization, organization is doomed for failure, because now what they are doing is, very conveniently, every business decision of bad debt will be converted into a fraud, which means that I am not accountable. The man was a fraud. He defrauded the bank. Let CBI go chase him. I am off the hook. Now, that if you follow that thesis forward, there is no future for these institutions, because nobody is going to lend money, nobody is going to borrow money, and everybody will eventually be turned into a defaulter, and everybody will be said he's a fraud, because no one is willing to say we made a bad business decision. And that's where the crisis is, that in banking, you will make some bad decisions, you'll make some good decisions. And therefore, getting this, you know, this whole witch hunt that one person perpetrated the fraud and everybody is now off the hook, I think is ruinous for the banking industry, and that is what is causing the demise in the perception of investors, or so-called investors, in this bank. That if this is the way the employees are going to react from the management, what future is left for these institutions?
Well, Ajay, I mean, actually, I do want to come in on that, and, you know, witch hunt, so to speak. But then, you know, this is a witch hunt that involves almost 12,000 crore rupees. You know, before I take the stock-specific question, I just have a question for Mr. Parekh as well. Now, sir, what happens to the likes of an IDBI bank? Because there, the market's big bet has been the government's divestment, a stake sale. I mean, that stock is still up 30% in this year. Any concept of a government stake sale, any M&A in PSU banks, does all that get pushed back now in light of recent events?
Yeah, see, I mean, let's look at each one in a different manner. You see, the first thing is, I mean, wherever there are NPA cases, and that may particularly be more relevant to IDBI. I mean, it's not a case of, let's say, any misapplication carried out by any particular borrower. I mean, we're talking about a bank which has managed to convert from a development financial institution to a universal bank with a lot of legacy assets sitting on the books. So IDBI perhaps is a little different one. But Surbhi, I take your question. M&A somehow or the other is getting pushed back. And I mean, I would subscribe to this view very clearly that this is not the time for M&A at all. I mean, if you're going to focus on recovery, if you're going to focus on NPAs, NCLT, you know, processes and resolution processes, then I suppose once again to add an additional burden, you know, of bankers getting sort of, you know, using their management time for mergers may not be an appropriate move at this point in time. So that's one thing that is becoming apparently clear. There's something else also, and it's something that, I mean, I've always been sort of, you know, at a macro level analyzing. I do believe that this entire issue, I'm not talking about frauds, I'm talking about NPAs. The issue of NPAs is also something to do with the economic performance. That's becoming evidently clear. If you look at the different asset classes, steel is getting some response. Other sectors are not getting response at this point in time. Who knows, after 8 quarters or 9 quarters or 10 quarters, the story may look very different. So I would say NPAs, and then any price change in the marketplace on arising out of NPAs, one story. Frauds, of course, is a different story altogether. I mean, the bankers, if they participate, you know, for example, then the investors do have a right to question. They lose, I mean, there's some amount of their sort of confidence in that particular bank for a while. I'm not too surprised with the names of the banks that you talked about, because these banks, three or four of them, are known to be active lenders for the diamond business. You know, so people may now start worrying about their diamond, exposures.
Okay. Ashwin Parikh, thanks a lot for your time. My sense is that, you know, we'll talk to you oftener now going forward, because these issues keep resurfacing. Ajay, you know, this is just to play devil's advocate, right? A lot of people believe the time to buy stocks is when you think that really, these are the worst possible, stocks or worst possible things happening here. At 98 on PNB, at current levels, say on Bank of Baroda, and at current price to book value on, say, a Canara Union, is there any merit in even thinking about a contra buy right now?
Well, let me put the answer. In a traditional situation, what you said, Anuj, is very correct. But here the situation is a little different because it's not over. You know, if things were over or things were coming to a culmination, you would say, yes, it's a good value buy. And why do you say it's a good value buy? Let's understand this. Because you're hoping that some other investor will turn around and pick up your stock, or there'll be privatization, or there'll be some institutional participation which will take off the stock from your hands. That's the bottom line of an arbitrage theory. Okay, I'm buying cheap and I should sell off. Nobody's buying these shares for a 5 year. It's not an HDFC bank where you want to keep for 10 years or 5 years and so on. So you want to buy a PNB at 98, you want to be able to flip it out for 130, 140 in a period of 3 months or 5 months. The problem here is that nobody knows where the bottom is at this point of time, because the way it's unfolding, that's why I said the way the whole thing is unfolding, is it's in a series of a situation where you do not know where it's going to end up. Because you may have 1,000 crores today, you have 2,000 crores tomorrow. And let's not make this 11,000 crore. You know, I think Surbhi mentioned 11,000 crore. What's the big deal, 11,000 crores? The steel companies have taken, and cement companies, and JP has taken right over 40,000 crores. So, you know, so let's keep in perspective that 11,000 crore, maybe there'll be a recovery of 4,000-5,000 crore or 6,000 crore. So you might lose 4,000-5,000 crore here or there. That's not the worry. The worry is not the quantum. The worry is the process. Where is it ending? Is it going to end up in a process where you kill all existing customers along with the older customer who went default? What will happen to the banking system? Will their NPAs mount? Because they will not issue LOCs anymore, and therefore old loans will start to become now NPAs because nobody can pay back the loan. If it will Reliance to pay back the loan today, can they pay back all the loans? The answer is no. So how does a diamond trader pay back the loans today? Now you want to go shut up the shops, you want to go do all the kind of stuff, which means you can't repay the loans. So we are looking at a scenario that it is like a bottomless pit where you're creating NPAs for yourself because of your conduct, which is why I say value play, but not today. Value play may come down the line once this process stops. It's just accelerating now, and I think we are just seeing 10% of the problem. I think you're going to see, Anuj, in the next 2 to 3 months, as LOCs start to mature, LCs start to retire, they will not issue the new LC. And that's when the chickens will come home to roost.